Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Jamestown United Methodist Church as we gather for worship this day. Wherever you are, whether it's at home in the den or at the kitchen table or up in the mountains or down at the coast, wherever you are, we are so glad that you are with us and hope that you feel connected to the congregation and to God, most importantly. One announcement I want to lift this morning is this evening our church council will be getting together to decide how we worship together for the rest of the year. And we value your prayers. This meeting will be taking place at 7 o'clock, so we ask for your prayers during this time. Also, the council appreciates all the ways that you have been patient during this difficult season and for your continued support of the ministries of Jamestown United Methodist Church. Thank you so very much. Friends, this is the hour of worship, and this is the house of the Lord. So let us worship God.
We're going to begin with hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 62, verses 1, 4, and 5.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing.
This week you should have received information for our 2021 stewardship campaign. Our theme this year is taken from a sermon preached by John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, and the sermon is entitled The Use of Money. Mr. Wesley preached this sermon because he wanted the people called Methodists to use their burgeoning wealth as a means to an important end, and that end, pleasing God and helping others. Mr. Wesley called money an excellent gift, and he offered three rules for the use of money. First, earn all you can. Second, save all you can. And third, give all you can. These three rules form the theme of our 2021 stewardship campaign. That theme, of course, earn all you can, save all you can, and give all you can. This morning, we will consider Mr. Wesley's first rule, earn all you can. And we thank you for all the ways that you continue to support this great church with your time, your talents, and your treasures. Now, as we enter into this time of pastoral prayer, invite you to remember a couple of names. First, Ashley Whitten, who will be having surgery this week, and Margot McMahon, who was recovering from surgery this past week. Would you join with me as we enter into this time of prayerful meditation? Gracious God, as your people gather for worship this day, your world around us changes seasons. All around us, as days grow shorter, as leaves change, we know that fall is upon us. The world around us changes, and we also change. We find it difficult to fulfill our good intentions. One day we feel close to you, the next far away. Our emotions run hot and cold. We are fickle, we change, but fortunately you don't. Through all the days of our lives, through the twists and turns and changes, your love has remained steadfast, and for this we give thanks. Because of your steadfast love throughout all the days of our lives, we love you, O God. And as we worship today, we show our love for you as we pray, as we listen to your scripture, and as we hear your word proclaimed. We offer this prayer and praise because of who you are. And we pray that you would help us to be the sort of people you want us to be. Teach us how to worship not only here on Sunday morning, but in our lives during the week as we move about in the world. May somebody look at us and see your transforming love at work in us. These things we pray in Christ's name, and we pray the prayer he taught his followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Our scripture this morning is found in Luke chapter 16, verses 1 through 9. Hear these words from the gospel. Jesus told his disciples, "There was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer.' The manager said to himself, 'What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses.' So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' 900 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "And how much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, "Take your bill and make it 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than they are the people of the light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings." Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Do you remember the first time that you were given money? Maybe it was a small weekly allowance, or you earned money from completing chores for good grades. Maybe the tooth fairy paid you a visit. I've heard that the tooth fairy is also fallen culprit to inflation. What did you do with that money? Keep it so you could add to the total? Spend it immediately on something that caught your eye? How did you decide what to do with your newly acquired wealth? Now, think back to the first time you made a decision that you regretted involving money. Did you empty your piggy bank for something that you didn't need? Or was an item purchased that turned out to be flimsy and was broken or useless within a few weeks? Did you receive that $20 in your birthday card, and perhaps instead of saving it or spending it on something nice, you spent it on soda or candy? There's a saying, "A fool and his money are soon parted." This saying suggests to us this morning that there is a relationship between wisdom and financial well-being. And like many things in life, when we approach stewardship, wisdom is the best place to start. And wisdom is so much more than knowledge or even intelligence. People who are wise are not only knowledgeable of what is right and true and just, but also use good judgment and discernment. Scripture has much to say about wisdom, and we too should strive to have a wise and discerning mind in all we do. Proverbs chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. "If you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, indeed, if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom." And then Matthew 7, 24 and through 29. "Therefore, anyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat that house, yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock." As we strive to be wise with our money, we must look with hope toward the source of all our wisdom, which is God. We start first by seeking God and wisdom. As David has already alluded to this morning, John Wesley, a co-founder of Methodism, was an influential 18th century clergyman and theologian who ministered during a quite turbulent time in England, where this disparity between the wealthy and the poor was quite stark. Wesley and the early Methodists were interested in transforming not just the Church of England, but the country as a whole. And this did include the financial situation of the country's poorest people and holding the rich accountable for how they use their wealth. Wesley, like us, understood the power of money to corrupt and destroy, but also recognized its power to do immense good. To help the early Methodists use their money in ways that were wise, that honored God, and were beneficial to God's people, Wesley introduced those three plain rules for the use of money: gain or earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. And these three plain rules will shape our stewardship conversations over the next few weeks. And so we start with the first plain rule: earn all you can. Money in and of itself is not evil, but our attitude towards money can be. It's fine to make money, but making money should never be our top priority. It should never control us. We should control it. And with the right attitude and the right perspective, money can be a tremendous asset. Jesus, like Wesley, also had quite a few things to say about money, including our main text this morning. And see, this is a strange parable where a manager cooks his books in order to gain favor of his customers so that when the boss fires him, his customers will help him out. And then the wealthy man commends the manager for his shrewdness. When we read the parable, it's very easy to get caught up in the dishonesty of the manager. But the main point is in how Jesus ends the parable, that we who are followers of Jesus need to be just as smart about how we use our resources as those who are not followers of Jesus. Wesley loved this parable, and in my research found that he's preached on this specific story at least 27 times. Because Wesley understood that money is an important part of our lives and that God calls us to be smart with how we handle all of our resources. Wesley saw that throughout England, the wealthy had a distinct interest in making more wealth and keeping the poor poor. Again and again, he found truth and hope in this particular parable. Because the parable is clear to us that Jesus wants us to be smart about how we use our resources, wise about how to earn and spend our money. It's a strange thing to say, earn all you can. Jesus never shied away from money. His desire was for people to earn money honestly and to use it for the kingdom of God. With wisdom, we can keep God at the forefront and use our money as a tool. So Wesley encourages us, gain, earn, make all that you can. But there are some stipulations to help us keep God at the forefront. First, Wesley says, earn all you can by honest industry, using all possible diligence in your calling. Now, there are a plethora of ways to make money that are dishonest and take advantage of people. Wesley never encouraged that. Instead, we are encouraged to think about what our calling is. How is God calling you to use your gifts and your talents and your skills? Jim Harnish, in his book, Earn, Save, Give, writes, seeing our work as a calling from God puts the challenge to earn all you can in the context of the larger purpose of our work. Wesley's instruction is not merely to earn money for its own sake, but to earn it for the higher purpose of fulfilling God's intention for our lives. Be diligent in following your calling, being sure not to waste your gifts or to waste an opportunity to make a living using those gifts. Second, Wesley says, earn all you can by common sense. Wesley urged his followers, You should be continually learning from the experience of others or from your own experience to do everything you have to do better today than you did yesterday. It is foolish to live life defined by our worth. It is wise to maintain the wider perspective. It is foolish to think that we have all the experience on our own. It is wise to gather wisdom from others. It is foolish to think the reason to earn money is to simply accumulate more. It is wise to use our wealth for a bigger purpose. It is foolish to manage money with no reference to God. It is wise to do so in light of our calling. The final stipulation that Wesley puts on earn all you can is to earn all you can without paying more for it than it's worth. Wesley breaks this down even farther for us. Earn all you can without paying too high of a price for it. Any job that negatively affects one's health physically, mentally, emotionally is not worth it. Earning all we can for God should not work against God's will that we live full and healthy lives. Earn all you can, but not at the expense of losing your soul. If what you're doing to earn all you can is destroying who you are, it's not worth it. Earn all you can, but not at the expense of your neighbor. At the center of the gospel in Wesley's theology is the greatest commandment, to love God, and the second commandment, to love our neighbor. When we do earn money, what we do to earn money should give people life, not injure body or soul. Earn all that you can in every way to honor God. This parable in Luke teaches us to be clever. Use the same wit and determination as those who cheat, but do it instead to glorify God and to bring about God's kingdom in this world. Be wise as God is wise. The world tells us to earn more money so that we can spend more, to make others rich, and even to be up to debt in our eyeballs. The world feeds our appetite of want by telling us to earn more and more and more. Wesley is giving us a similar message, yet for a very different reason. Wesley encouraged people to earn all the money they could so that they could save all the money they could, so that they could give all the money they could. He saw that in order to be freed up to do what God is calling us to do, we needed to focus on trusting God while also using our skills, our gifts, and our talents to share with the world. Everything, all to God's glory. Jesus calls us to be wise with every aspect of our lives, and that includes our money. So earn all you can. Let us pray. God of your calling and our riches, open our hearts to understand fully and share joyfully the lessons learned about our relationship with money we earn and use. As your church in and for the world, we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, as we enter this season of stewardship, we start first with yearning and running and seeking after your wisdom. As we seek to earn all we can, save all we can, and give all we can, may our lives be built upon the foundation of who you are. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Friends, we are sad that we could not worship with you in person, but it has been great to worship with you on the other side of the screen this morning. Go from your home, go from this place that you are in, out into the world to serve and to love others. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.